Hello, I'm Ishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture in hopefully a smoother manner than what the manner in which the talking at the beginning of the video started. Let's just keep going. I know that the first minute of this video probably won't be the best, which means that there's some quality in store later on. If I just can get there, let's hope that I won't get lost in the way. The video, it should go without saying that I didn't really prepare at all, and I usually don't. I hope that my past research would count as the preparation, and I would have enough to just improvise the content of this video. But anyway, what I wanted to talk about with this particular video was something like philosophy of the one. Now, when I talk about philosophy of the one, I don't mean any pre-Socratic philosophers who thought that all in the world was one and one was all, or something like that. Not at all. It's this is something closer to talking about the mating habits of humans. Now, in that type of discussion, when talking about the one, I would imagine that, everyone should be able to more or less know what it is that people mean when they say the one, romantically speaking about. But I would imagine that most of the audience is sort of clearly divided into two camps. So there are those who just genuinely do believe that there is a soulmate, let's say, for everyone. And that perhaps there's even some type of metaphysical fatalism related to that soulmate. Whether or not that's the case, we don't need to get into that. Let's just say that there are some people in the audience who do think that such things as soulmates exist for some people, and that your soulmate would clearly be the one you have been waiting for in your life, and so on. But then there are lots and lots of other people who perhaps at some time in their life they have either believed that they might have a soulmate, or maybe they were somewhat agnostic when it came to it, but then later in life I guess they would see that they would have become disillusioned, and they would try to get others to be disillusioned as well, and to they would recommend people not to believe that there's any kind of soulmates, that there would be just one partner. I mean, I suppose if a person is on a mission to have as many partners as possible, I guess they would have a reason to talk. I guess they would have the philosophy of the many rather than the philosophy of the one. I don't know who would be the pre-Socratic counterparts of the different parties to this kind of discussion, but we don't need to get into that. So I just set the stage, sort of stating the obvious about people's general opinions when it comes to this particular side of love. But anyway, I have something new to add for this particular video. So that's my whole reason for making it, in that I was reading, I suppose it would be a Spanish book, although it feels Japanese because the subject matter was Japanese. I was wandering around in the local library and I happened to see a new book called Ikigai, which had a subtitle called something like The Secret for the Long Life of the Japanese, or something like that. I can't remember what it was, but it was a very slim volume of non-fiction, and I don't know, I have a certain interest in Japanese culture, and so I just, on the spur of the moment, decided to check out what this Ikigai book was all about. And anyway, I thought that there was a certain graph in the book which I sort of I recreated here. So I'll show it again later. Of course, you can pause it if you want to look at the if for whatever reason you would want to look at how it is that I recreated it. Anyway, there just happened to be a graph in the book about Ikigai, and there was a visual representation of like different parts of our experience of our lives and the world in general. So anyway, the idea, for instance, that how it is that you get something like your passion, which is here, is that there are your experiences of the things that you love. And then there are also your experiences of things where you're good at. And your passion would be where what you love and where you're good at would overlap. And for instance, the idea with this graph is that there are things in the world where you can earn your wages. Your profession will be where you're good at and where you can earn your wages overlap. So if you're just good at something, but it's more like a hobby, you know, if you can't earn your wages there, your hobby can't become your profession. But if you can earn your wages somewhere and you're good at that, it can become your profession. So that's somewhere where overlap happens. Then there's, people's experience of what the world needs. And if there's an overlap between what the world needs and where you can earn your wages, the overlap can be like your calling or your, well, I think calling is a better word than vocation. But anyway, you know, that can be your calling. But anyway, like the interesting thing why there's some why the book was about this Japanese concept of Ikigai is that there are fields where this like these circles overlap with each other, but there's only one place where each of the four circles, things you love, things you're good at, things you can earn your wages in, what the world needs. That the only place where all of that overlaps is Ikigai. at the center. And anyway, like, what does, I mean, if I had to explain Ikigai, if you know the French term joie de vivre, the reason why people say joie de vivre even in English is because there isn't a direct English equivalent, but it's just somebody having a good disposition, somebody enjoying their life. If you take joie de vivre, and that a person who has found their place in the world, let's say some people find their place in the world through their profession, some through their family, friends, their partner, some perhaps even through religion or through politics or something. But anyway, if you found your place in the world and you are just existing in that place, when you are as if getting joie de vivre in you having found your place in the world, I suppose the process of going on in where you belong, that would be the Japanese concept of ikigai, that you find your meaning of life in being where you feel like you belong. And it gives you energy. Like, ikigai, I suppose, is the positive energy. When you have found where you belong, there's like positive energy running through everything that you're doing, because you found the way to make everything in your life work in your favor. So something like that is the Japanese philosophy of ikigai. Obviously, they wouldn't use the Japanese word if a perfect counterpart existed in the English language. So that's why you have to use the foreign term. But anyway, why it is that I talk about this ikigai in relation to the mating habits of humans? Well, because I think that something like this debunk the people who are skeptical about the one. I have a certain romanticism about me, and I certainly believe in soulmates. Very unequivocally. I mean, to me there isn't any anything fanciful about it. Perhaps it says something about me that I can just go along with it, but so it is. I mean, I don't think there's anything farcically impossible about the idea of a soulmate. And I hope that this graph could maybe hope to, illustrate my case as to why this. Because if, for instance, we talk about the one with love, I mean, wouldn't this central position of the ikigai, ikigai position here, wouldn't that almost be like the one in this graph, in that there's only one area where each of the four circles overlaps? And so, ikigai, the joie de vivre that comes when you have found your place of belonging, and the positive energy. Like, if ikigai is sort of, it's like a comparable situation to having found the one. Just like there wouldn't be anything like there wouldn't be anything impossible or fanciful about if some of the criticisms towards modern life and our contemporary society is that whenever there are people who are unhappy here and now, it's because their life is permanently out of balance. And there's a vicious circle that they can get back into balance because they are out of balance. So there's a situation that some people have as it were, they have fallen and they can't get up, and some people will laugh, but I mean, it's an unfortunate tragedy that some people have, is that there is a vicious circle, it perpetuates itself and nothing can be done, and like the real end point in, you know, some people having a life out of balance is that because they've been unbalanced for so long, they've even forgotten what being balanced even feels like. So they've just gotten so profoundly lost in this modern world they would if all old-fashioned truths about what the answers to a good life are ignored, then I don't know what to say to those people who I guess think that they are better off alone amidst confusion and indifference. I don't know what to say, but I would just hope that if some people try the modern ethos and find it not to their liking, that they would be able to perhaps find their way out of it as well. And well, perhaps a few videos that I do here and there might be my ways of, defending the old-fashioned notions, and this would be that. But anyway, if all kinds of bad forms of existence would be life out of balance, then, what this Ikigai graph shows is that this is... Ikigai, I suppose, is something like a masterpiece of life imbalance, in that, if we look at the four circles, there are things that you are good at, and there are things you love, there are things that the world needs, and the places where you can earn your wages, like four situations. Two situations that recognize the individual and two situations that recognize the rest of the world. So, there's two situations, both are counterbalancing each other, and then what the balanced life will be is something that... life that knows how to life that knows how to find happiness in constructing itself from something and also its opposite. So you know, if you look at the graph, for instance, the overlap between what you're good at and what the world needs, it's not really recognized much, but the overlap actually isn't that great. You know, I mean, much of what the world needs would be, you know, it would be outside the scope of abilities of, you know, what the person would be good at anyway. So, like, I mean, to me, that just seems like a very realistic situation in that there are so many things that the world needs, and yet a human being isn't able to do everything. But, you know, to me, that's still, like, even though there's so much of what the world needs that falls outside the ability of a given person, but it's still recognized to be there as like a counterbalance to everything. Like, you know, it's almost like a good, healthy psyche needs the rest of the world to counterbalance itself, so that, you know, the act of counterbalancing yourself with awareness of the world outside, that is basically the key to health, that you are using your awareness of the world, and in this particular instance, what the world needs. You know, like that ability to counterbalance, I think it's the secret to Ikigai. And anyway, like the other counterbalance is that there are things you love, but again, like it seemed that in this circle of what you love, quite a lot of it is falling outside of the recognized world. So sometimes what you love and what the world needs overlaps, but sometimes, you know, a lot of what you love will simply be a private thing. But it's, again, like the secret to Ikigai is that, yes, there are things you love, but you counterbalance it to something that's almost like the opposite. So like, where you can earn new wages. So like, if you think that those are like, you know, almost like duties or chores, like you find happiness in being able to counterbalance things, so that you know, that life isn't all sugar and sweets, but that you get your life to happen you get your life happen where things are the most meaningful, when there's, I guess, the greatest general diversity into what you're doing, in that you don't fall into merely one thing, but you are keeping yourself, you know, in a balanced position to exist in the multiple spheres. So, like, you know, if the secret to Ikigai is finding how it is that life reaches a kind of, you know, quiet grandeur when it's balanced, like, I would imagine that most young people, like, the last thing they want to hear is that being balanced would be some kind of a holy grail of being alive. I understand that it's not the sexy option, but anyway, You know, you react to Ikigai how you will, but anyway, I just tried to reference what that tradition is. But anyway, then how it is that love might come to be explained through this, notion of the Ikigai is that, if you think of your psyche when it comes to love, in that you might likewise see the overall situation with these four different general circles, and I would say that what soulmates are is something comparable to this Ikigai at the center is when another person comes along and they are able to basically everything that will make you the person you are able to balance all of that with the other person, basically connecting everything, tying everything together. Like, to me, that's what people see soulmates as being. Like, somebody who... A person who allows you to be who you are, but even more than that, who almost ultimately makes you the person who you are, because they are there creating the circumstances where all of this is made possible. So, like, of course, the situations inside a person's psyche, they would all have a kind of existence even without the other person, but it's as if what this balance of Ikigai does is that it just lends a more meaningful reality to everything when it's not just some kind of a, wind that comes and goes, that, your perception of reality, that it's not just some kind of a wind that comes and goes, and it's just that, whims that toss you around, but that you can have the experiences it's as if that you can almost have the experiences on your terms and not not just have the kind of situation where where you feel like much of what you feel like your life should be is not in the here and now, that some things would be just a distant dream, or that something would make you bitter that, the rest of reality isn't in sync with you or something. Like, what Ikigai does, like, the secret strength to Ikigai is that, if people whose life is out of balance, if the great problem is that they are not in sync with the rest of their surroundings, what Ikigai does is that it restores that connection. And so, why it is that life can happen a bit more meaningfully with Ikigai, so it seems to claim, is that because it restores that lost connection, because yes, that's the thing. Because if your life is out of balance, something is monopolizing your attention. But when your life is in balance, there's no one particular thing that's monopolizing your attention. So you are present to have a given experience the way that it sort of should be had, and that you know, you are able to connect with it in a more meaningful manner than you would be if you would be in some kind of a more insular situation where the experience is somehow distorted in ways that it shouldn't be. But anyway, as I suggested, I think that soulmates are that so with soulmates. It is a comparable situation in that nothing else will connect all of the different circles as a soulmate does. So a soulmate alone could get to that central situation. So I guess some of the people who would speak against soulmates, they might be people who I would probably see as those whose life is out of balance. And perhaps they've resigned to the reality that their life has been out of balance and their life very likely will keep being out of balance. And so, you know, if other people would have more of a fondness for balance, they speak irreverently about those traditions and say that doesn't correspond to their perception of reality, but I think that the kind of psychology behind the situation that it's perfectly sound, and there's nothing, you know, fairy tale type fanciful about the idea that you know, you would, well, that another person would be the missing link, that another person. That another person, just as they are, gives you your place of belonging. That the other person, just as they are, would somehow just like complete you. And you know, how that completing would happen is that, of course, the elements that you have, like the other person doesn't add anything. Like the other person doesn't add any new element. What the other person does is that they bring the possibility of balanced life. You know, like I think the reason why some people think that there's something fanciful about soulmates is that they think that there's some mumbo jumbo that somebody like would you know, cast some sort of a spell that would distort reality or something like that. I don't think that's the case. It says that some people who have been living out of balance and who are made miserable because of it, if another person should come along, bring the possibility of love and bring balance with it, like the people who had been living without balance, who get the balance restored, like they are just, they start waxing, you know, lyrical about the other person. But I mean, I don't think that there's anything more fanciful going on than you know, like if life out of balance would like have a given person have one of these circles monopolize their attention, they are somehow left unsatisfied with their main experience, because they just feel like there's something too limited about simply living all your life with just one circle. But like the reason why some people are so into love or into a given soulmate is because they just seem like life happens more richly, more meaningfully, in bolder colors, when you as if get all four circles through the one connected situation of the soulmate. So, as I said, I think that there's several reasons to think that these kinds of old-fashioned notions, which some don't want to hear of, that they do have some kind of tried and true wisdom about it. I mean, obviously, there are people who will say that they have tried, but they haven't found soulmates to be true. Well, you know, I mean, obviously, it goes without saying that there are lots of people who are not in a profoundly satisfying relationship and so on, but I don't know what to say about that, but you know, if it's a truism to say that some people are unhappy in love, well, not everyone is. Like, you know, throughout the centuries, like, some people have found their happiness from love, and I think that everyone who would have found happiness in love could perhaps be able to co-sign something like this kind of Ikigai graph about just why and how love can make somebody happy. Of course, there's passions involved and so on, but like the kind of quiet, secret joy in balance, I don't know if I've quite heard anyone talk about it. So I suppose that's why I thought that there's something worth doing in this particular video. If I could just, you know, like, I mean, this is, I guess, like, you know, for your consideration type type idea, that just like some people think that Ikigai was the secret to a long and happy life, perhaps love as a culture has just such a general reality to it that the structural similarity to the secret of long and happy love would be similar to the structural route to a long and happy life as told by Ikigai. But anyway, that was just sort of my idea for this video. I don't have much to say about the book as such. There was some ideas thrown around about how to live a long and happy life and so on. But anyway, like my idea that life and love would be alike in this manner. That was what I felt most passionate about, and hence this video. So anyway, I don't know what else to say. As I said, it was just a kind of for your consideration type thinking that the that resulted in this video, and I hope that I could make my case somehow intelligibly. But anyway, there it was. I thank you for watching, and